Pick it up.
No, hold your cocktail
yeah.
stick at the top.
Yeah, yeah, no.
So the first question I want to ask you guys is that we all know that you guys are connoisseurs of street food, but we have a new food culture, a new and emerging high-end food culture from Nouvelle Indian cooking. So have you guys had a chance to try much of that?
Yes, and we hate it all. No, I'm just kidding.
Of course.
No, it's very nice. There's a lot of good stuff happening over there, but somebody has to focus on the traditional foods of India, which are going out of use very fast. I mean, we have a lot of these new expressways coming through. The dhaba as we know it, the street side, the roadside, highway side dhaba is going to fizzle out. And a lot of recipes are not cooked anywhere else now at homes, only on dhabas. And this is truer the further south you go. But we need to preserve these places as well. So while there is a huge market and a great appreciation for all the new sort of good food coming into the country, the more delicate tastes.
But is there, I mean, is this, I mean, is there a sense of people just turning up to these restaurants because they want to be seen there? Or do you think there is a genuine culture emerging around fusion food or novel food or, you know, the back to the basics French thing that they've started using, batwa for lasagna, you know, stuff. Some of that stuff works.
Well, but we'll still do it. I think we'll still do it. But, you know, as people travel more, as they read more, as the economy pushes them into a zone where they have access to more things, the palate does mature, the palate grows. And even though my favorite could be a, you know, could be a butter chicken at one of Delhi's wonderful butter chicken places, but I will still be able to appreciate a fine meal with the rarest of ingredients. So I think that's how we're progressing. We have such a flexible palate as Indians. We can go either way, and our range is just tremendous because of the food that we have in our country. So I think there's a market for both.
No,
but,
sure.
This is where our heart is, you know.
But have you guys tried any of the stuff that really works? I mean, any of the fusion cuisine that's gone beyond bakery and really worked for you guys? Do you remember any?
Not really. I mean, if you are going to eat,
I'm talking about high end. I'm not talking about Szechuan dosa. I'm talking about high end.
You know, even in high end, I mean, they come up with all sorts of very interesting names. This fusion, that fusion. I'm just speaking for myself. I like.
Yeah.
Pure taste. So if I'm going to eat Thai food, I want Thai food that tastes like Thai food. If I want to eat Italian, I want to eat it with Italian sauces, with good cheese. But as for me, I always come back to Indian food. I mean, I've tried every taste there is to try. It's what works for me.
I think the argument for experimentation is that we need to develop new recipes and we need to, you know, it shouldn't be a dead culture. Food should not be a dead culture. It should be more evolving. But I don't know if it's helping. I don't know if there are really any new things coming up. I, for one, haven't tried, with due respect, anything that has. I mean, it might have tasted good, broccoli khichdi or whatever, in that moment. But I haven't tried anything that I feel like could actually take, you know, change the way we think about food.
I think more than a sort of expansion on what's happening, I think it's a coming together. So if we take, let's say, sort of classic European cuisine, and we pitch it at one end of the spectrum with its subtle flavoring and its gentle tastes and its, you know, sort of highlighting ingredients and stuff like that. And then we take Indian cooking, classic Indian cooking. It's on the other end of the spectrum. It is a completely different animal. So there's 100 spices in there blended in to produce one unique taste. I mean, that's, so there is no sort of ground for expansion on the other side. We're actually merging these cuisines. And that's nice. Anything that merges and, you know, something new comes out and we sort of have a halfway ground to meet. I mean, the curry, for example, the chicken tikka masala, the Balti curries of the UK are famous.
Yeah.
So they've made a huge step coming forward to adopt our cuisine.
Okay, but do they personally work for you?
I'm a little more puritanical about my taste. You know, I'm a hardcore Indian spice guy. I don't like food without spice. Thai food is my other favorite cuisine. Plenty of spice. I like Indian cuisine. Plenty of spice. I need a punch in my food and my drink. Excuse me when I take a big sip of my whiskey.
It's very, very scary.
That's where I go.
If you're talking about all these things merging, you're going to talk about croissants dipped in chashni or a kachori with Philadelphia cream cheese.
Actually,
I'm getting excited.
I bet someone's tried that.
We interviewed this celebrity chef called Manish Mehrotra, and he said
never heard of him.
And he said that he would draw the line at focaccia with chicken curry, and would not go as far as dal makhani pizza, which is something that celebrity chef Vineet Bhatia serves up in London.
Right.
So you think that lines need to be drawn? Or?
I like the sound of it, you know.
Dal makhani pizza is something you try?
I'm not one for preserving the purity of any lineage. You know,
but
I'm,
would you try? Would you
fascism,
try dal makhani?
Fascism went out in the 40s with the Nazis. So the more mix up there is.
Answer the question. Would you try?
Yes. The more mix up there is, the more I'll enjoy it. So yes.
You'll try it.
The more types of
would
things.
Would you pay £100 for it and try?
No. That's an easy one.
Okay, how conservative are you guys when it comes to food? When you know, in actual practice, not what you encourage or promote, but in actual practice, when you order a meal by yourselves, do you often, especially you as a vegetarian, you know, do you look for tastes that? Because it, I mean, I'm a vegetarian, and I know that it's for us, it's rarer to find new tastes. So, do you guys go for that, or do you guys just order what is?
The only thing I've really been able to find is there's a place that does very nice Malaysian food. I'm not going to plug. Their vegetarian dishes I find are very, very interesting. But then again, because they use a lot of the similar spices that India uses.
This is in Delhi or this is
in Malaysia? Yeah, it's in Delhi. You can phone out, call in. I think they're pretty close somewhere here. And they do that. But besides that, no. I mean, we went and traveled on the show to Sri Lanka, to Malaysia, to Singapore, to Mauritius. And in every place, we found an overwhelming presence of spices that we're used to in any Indian kitchen. So it's not that hard anyways, even to go to like slightly different cuisines and have that familiarity of taste. I like that.
This is something I want to ask.
But answering your question more specifically, yes. I think every time we go in, we'll pretty much pick what we haven't eaten and order that. Now you have to sort of put into context that our palates have been stretched beyond imagination. I mean, we've traveled to every state in this country. Almost to every big town.
Not our waist, not our belts, only our palates.
Yes, only our palates.
Please note.
You can't tell by looking at us, but we have. And once you've stretched your palate that much, I think you really appreciate things that you haven't eaten before. So yeah, we will.
How often do you guys actually find a taste that's like, wow, this is good or bad, but this is radical. This is radically different.
Day before yesterday, bhojohari manna?
All the time. Especially when you, I don't even want to call it work, when you do what we do. Every day that you're out on the road, you'll find something new, something that surprises you, something like, and you come back with like bottles of it all saved up, like share with everybody. So yeah, every day.
Okay, really, where do you personally see this whole, you know, this new fascination for wine and this new fascination for fusion, experimental Indian high-end cuisine? Where do you see it going? Do you think that it's eventually going to evolve into something?
You ask me that as we munch away on hugely spiced snacks. I think that answers where I see it going.
Fine.
I wouldn't be able to tell a good wine from a flying
pig,
parrot,
or a horse's ass.
or a horse's ass. Puts it into context perfectly. That's what I like about these journalists. They just
give my
know
dick
how to
back.
Give
my dick back.
Oh,
you promoted it, okay, then you can have it back.
So yeah, I mean, you know, the day I see a flying horse's ass, I will recommend wine for lovers of true Indian food because we just don't get it. I mean, garlic, onions, chilies, spices, ginger. You name one thing over there that will help you
and
appreciate
delicately
good wine.
Spiced Chardonnay.
Not to miss the hint. Perhaps if you sniff it through your nose, you know, wine has a future in India. But
please, sir.
No, thank you.
I have a different take on that. And my take is this, is that India as a country, as a culture, we're still a growing market in everything. I mean, that's why everybody loves us. And even with food, this is not going to segment the market or anything. It's just going to grow. More people are going to get experimental. More people are going to try. But the base is always there.
I think that it's definitely going to be a market for the future. I'm just not sure it's going to be a culture for the future. It's going to be...
Well, we have our own culture and I like it just fine the way it is.
Sure. I'm going to swiftly move on to the next question. What does the term food porn mean to you guys?
Food porn?
Mm.
Don't stop.
Let me show you. So we went to Bhojohari Manna,
mm-hmm.
and then they had
I didn't expect to start this way.
They had like four sets of crabs that came out. And they had a light coconut spicing and mustard and the gravy in there. And I'm vegetarian.
No, stop.
That works for me. That's so works for me.
But the real bit comes when you actually sink your teeth into it, like anything else.
No more. I can't do this on television. Is this an adult's rating or is it for everybody?
Adult's rating.
Don't stop. I'm almost there.
Chilika Lake Prawns.
Oh, yeah. And here's the after porn kachori, which is a traditional must on our.
It's the proverbial cigarette after the meal.
Okay, are you guys smell people where food is concerned or sight people where food is concerned? You have to choose.
You need all senses to be able to appreciate good food.
Sure.
So when we are walking far away, I mean, it's like saying, what do you like? No, I shouldn't say that. That's really bad.
That's a relevant question even otherwise.
When we are far away, then we smell people because that's what draws us in. But once we're there, then we're sight people because that's what we need then. And then when we sit down, we're taste people because that's what needs to go in.
If you were blind, you wouldn't eat that food if the smell took you there.
No, I just won't be able to find it.
Suppose you can.
You think?
You think it's better to eat when the lights are out, when it's complete darkness? There's a restaurant in New York and a restaurant in Japan that serves food in complete darkness.
Yeah.
I can't remember what it's called right now.
Say that enhances the taste and this one.
Or they have nostril napkins. I mean, I'd be stuffing food all places if I didn't have the lights on. So no, I need the lights. No. I like to look at my food. I'm an Indian, for God's sake. You know, I don't eat anything that's not fresh. I don't eat anything that's frozen. I don't eat anything that's not got a huge amount of spice and a kick in it. And I don't eat anything that I really can't see is all good before I put it in my mouth.
Do both of you cook?
I do omelets. Really nice omelets.
Good ones. Promise. Okay.
And you?
No, I cook Indian, North Indian, Mughlai, and I cook Thai.
Okay. How far would you go to find recipes? I mean, what like, is it just a... Like, do you cook functionally or do you look for recipes?
Well, here's the great part about our job. When you're walking out on the street and you meet the street food guy who's got half the city telling you that he's absolutely incredible. You know, that's the power of street food. Mm. Okay. That's the power of street food. When you walk out over here and ask people on the road about the fanciest restaurant in Delhi, they won't be able to give you an answer. But you ask them about Kareem's, or you ask them about Nand Ke Chole, or you ask them about, Pandara Road.
30 kilometers away, ask them.
And they would have all eaten there, they would have loved the food, and they'll give you that recommendation. So that should really tell a story, you know, that's huge. I mean, it's, reputation is everything. And in India, you walk 100 yards, and 100 miles, and you'll find a place with an incredible reputation, and they have unique recipes. So I've been sort of begging, borrowing, arm twisting and threatening recipes out of people. And I've got a huge collection, but I promise not to put it out, so I can't put it out. But yes, we will go to great lengths to
find a good recipe. Do you
experiment
with them?
Sacrilege!
Oh,
no,
that's
no!
Your own kitchen.
Please refer to the earlier section where we talked about experimenting with certain types of things. No.
And this one doesn't fit in that category for sure.
Okay.
Sacrilege! You're talking about changing legends. How can you?
Fine. Tell me about your food cooking accent.
Like, it's like putting a mustache on
Marilyn Monroe.
Marilyn Monroe.
I think that's a great idea. Vajanti Mala, I'm not sure, but Marilyn Monroe is a great idea. I don't know where that came from. Okay. Tell me your cooking eccentricities. Do you cut and chop, and or do you want someone to cut and chop for you?
Yeah, I mean, I have cut and chop days where I feel like just digging into those ingredients. But usually, if it's all set up and laid out for me, I'd like to just come in and throw things together. Because that just leaves you more artistic room.
Come on, peasants, bring me the
Bring your focus at the final objective. You know, it's like a surgeon. Somebody opens you up and gets you ready, and the surgeon comes in and pulls out a pipe and plugs in a little stent, and he's out of there. He's a specialist. I like behaving like I am. Because it's more fun like that, you know?
Okay, tell me about food writing. Do you guys... follow food writing? I mean, there isn't a big culture of food writing or food criticism in India, but do you guys otherwise, Anthony Bordua or anybody whose work that you read, or food novels like Water for Chocolates or food movies, is there anything that...
For me, no. As with sport, I don't like watching sport on television. I like going out and playing it. I don't like reading or watching stuff. No, I'd rather just get to a place, talk to people, find out, get invited in homes. And we've done that all over the world. Just landed up at people's places and got ourselves invited and just eat a good meal. I find it easier to do that. I don't want to read books about it or watch a show about it.
Yeah, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, you know, Anthony Bourdain has his place and he's wonderful. And so are all of them. But getting them to eat Indian food is like getting a fish to go from Jaipur to Jodhpur by road. It's just not a good idea. They don't have the sort of extent on their palates to be able to justify Indian food and its flavors. Because a lot of food they just can't eat, let's face it. There's a lot of food on the street that they can't eat because they'll be in hospital. There's a lot of food that they can't eat because they will burn their faces off for about 4 hours. There's a lot of food they can't eat because their palate has never experienced such bursts of flavor and bursts of spice. So I would read them if they help my cause, but no, I don't read them. There are, however, a lot of good Indian writers who are writing about street food particularly. And a few come to mind, and I won't say your names because that's competition, but they're very good. They're very good. And when you read them, you get a real flavor of this country in those articles, and I love that. So I'll follow those guys. And of course, you know, we have our own trail to blaze. We've been to more dhabas and roadside eateries in this country than anyone else alive. And I'm putting that out there for anyone to take up. More places and more cuisines than anyone else alive in India. That's what we've done. 4 years on the road, we're eating a different place almost every day. So I think we're blazing trails where no one's ever been before. So what's the point of reading anybody else? Okay. And if you knew how to write, you would have been doing it, but we do it quite often.
What about the knowing how to read bit?
Yes, that would help as well.
Okay. Which would have to bring me to all the adventures? I mean, every time I'm watching you guys on TV, because I'm vaguely in the same profession, you guys are drinking that bhang thing, and I'm wondering...
Says the girl with the swelled waist.
I'm wondering... how many takes did you need for that? You know, I'm wondering of, because you guys also, you don't shoot in antiseptic environments. There are people around you all the time. It's, and even with the book. So I'm wondering what, you know, I've always wanted to ask you guys this. What, tell me about adventures.
95% of the stuff is done on a single take.
Really?
Yeah. We started this whole...
You've never had to have 3 glasses of bhang before you could get the right take?
No, deliberately sometimes.
But we've had occasions, and I'll share one of those. We show that in our bloopers a lot. But the whole idea of the show is to actually try and make it real experience. Just get up there and get it going. Once in a while, if you flub a line or something, or you mispronounce something, you might take it. But the action is just captured always exactly how it is. If you travel India, you have a big group of people, you can't really tell them what to do. They're going to do what they have. You can't say, picha ho jao and stand aside. No, 2 seconds later, there are people there. We've had times where we just incorporated those people. There's a guy who, like a drunk guy, who walked in the middle of us and the camera once, twice, while Rocky's in the middle. So Rocky just grabbed him, made him stand in between and said, this guy's having a good time. Come on, talk to the camera. So I think between the director and Rocky and I, whatever we have to basically cover the basic things of this is where we are. We know that bit, and everything else is on the fly.
No food debacles?
No, you know, acting is reacting, and if we don't react when we're on camera, then I think the show would be very different. So not too many takes. But sorry, what was your question?
No food debacles that
no,
don't get to make it to the camera?
Eating too much, usually. But by and large, making pigs of ourselves, curries on the cheeks, and...
Dhoti's falling off.
Trying
to hitch a ride.
Yeah.
But to come back to the example for one second, there was a time.
This one, we went on a tempo and the guy said, all right, jump on, get on the back and we'll give you a ride. So both of us jumped on the back and the tempo went up. So it was standing on its back. So yeah, we couldn't use that shot. But apart from things like that, no, not too much. Not to the food. We're pretty...
And food poisoning? Come on, you can't.
What's food poisoning?
Three in one.
After
I
had it once.
3 in 1.
And I knew I was in trouble. I ate this chicken and I went inside to wash my hands and I walked through and I saw the chickens marinated lying on the ground near a cow shed with lots of cow pies around. I was like, oh my God, I'm dead. And probably that's why I got sick. Otherwise,
it's probably psychosomatic.
Yeah.
And you thrice.
3 times.
Really? That's pretty awesome.
What doesn't kill you will make you fat. That's one of those things that is the truth of the world. So we've pretty much eaten everything, and now I think the stomachs have got used to punishment. But a lot of it is clean as well. I mean, we're looking at Indian street food, which has a very high turnover. So it's very rare that you'd actually get something that's not good. I mean, even a pan, for example, has been continuously churning out food. So will you get sick? Perhaps, you know, if you're not capable of dealing with the sort of different bacteria that we have in our country, then that's going to happen to you anyway. But I think if you're out on the road a few times and you can grit your teeth and go through the two or three times that it happens to you, by the fourth time, you'll be liberated.
And you really can't, when you run a dhaba, you can't really afford to get your passengers sick, because a lot of your passengers are very large truck drivers. So if your food's not hot and it doesn't taste nice or it makes you sick, you're going to be sure the dhaba guy is going to like have to answer some very hard questions to the truck driver and his friends the next time around. So normally it's fresh, it's hot, comes out there, you eat it, you pay your bill, you say thank you, you go away and you're happy.
He will pay in teeth. Yeah.
Okay, a serious question. I remember you guys went to Rishikesh Haridwar. No, it's not about religion.
Yes.
It's about globalization. But I remember you guys going to a place where you suddenly found that a lot of, one of you had been there before, and a lot of the menu was replaced by burgers and pizzas and things such like that.
Chotiwala,
I think.
Rishikesh.
I'm wondering, is this a real concern? I mean, not just the McDonaldization, but the homogenization of food. Is, while you're traveling, is it becoming more and more difficult to find? I'm sure you guys still get your fill of original, wonderful, surprising recipes. But is it a real concern that original street food is
Absolutely, I think it's a huge concern. Yeah. There's even in the small town and stuff, you have malls and you have all this fast food, and you see a lot of people going there. And a lot of the street food culture is dying out.
Yeah, but a place like Chotiwala, for example, I mean, it can't possibly exist as a traditional Indian eatery, because you have a lot of foreigners coming in there now. So as tourism grows and more people come in, they want to eat something that they're familiar with, like we do. Indians are notorious. Whenever we go out of the country, we want to eat Indian food. And I'm totally like that. I carry a bottle of pickle with me sometimes when I go, because, you know, I'll just eat whatever bland food the rest of the world seems to offer westwards, and put pickle on it, which helps me survive. But so once you have a lot of foreigners coming in, you will have to change your menu to survive. So particularly for Chotiwala specifically, that's the problem with him. But there are a whole lot of eateries.
But Rocky,
they
could keep whatever they've been used to serving and add to that. Or do you think that economically?
Yeah, I think there is a certain limitation to how much food these dhabas can put out. They have two or three guys inside whipping up things together. But yeah, keeping all factors considered, ideally they should add on more, but it's a lot more work and the market shrinks. So, you know, actual street food considerations are very different. You would rather be making a chana bhatura and just selling that to 20,000 people in a month, as opposed to making 25 things and selling them to 1,000.
But it's not a real burger. Actually, that brings me to another question. Have you had interesting accidental fusion cuisine?
Oh, love it. It's perfect.
Yeah.
Papars, masala papars with Nutella.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Amazing. Some places,
wow.
The room
amazing.
Service is not fun. There's nothing. So you ask for masala papar and somebody has a jar of Nutella in the bag. Masala papar. No, that's good fusion cuisine.
Improvisation.
Especially at 3 o'clock in the morning.
I'll tell you what's a good fusion cuisine. You take lots of mashed potato, put plenty of onions, a little bit of really nicely roasted garlic, red chilies, coriander seeds powdered, cumin, salt, red chili powder, green chilies chopped up,
food porn.
Make a little patty out of it, fry it on both sides in a lot of butter, and then stick it between a pav and fry it on both sides again in a lot of butter, and take a bite, and you will know. No,
can
I
get
you? Thank you. And you will know what true fusion cuisine is, because that
is
the
not
best
Indian
burger.
Vada pav, guys.
The best burger
Indian
you will ever be able to eat is that one. I mean, if you're listening out there is a huge market for that.
Wait, can I at least touch you?
Yeah, okay. Lightly.
That was great.
Go on,
so, Indian-Italian is also great, like Indian-Chinese?
Oh, yeah, which we love it. You know, we're a powerhouse. How can you take the Indian away from any food that you're serving in India? So, if you're having Chinese, you've got to be Indian-Chinese. If you're having Italian, it's going to be Indian-Italian. I mean, if you go to a wedding, and all of you have been there to a slightly up-and-coming wedding, you will find the pasta counter. Go to the Indian food counter and bring out a few of your best curries and plug them into the pasta counter and watch the chef wince as he prepares a concoction. And then you will really enjoy that pasta.
You've done that?
Absolutely. I always do it. But you see these really sort of la-di-da people walking around and quietly whispering to the guy saying, put some red chilies in that pasta, lots. Okay. So, you know, why play around with it? Just own up to it. We have a great food cuisine in India, so we've got to sort of take advantage of it.
Okay, final question. Food fantasies and food pilgrimages that you guys haven't done as yet and want to do.
You do the fantasy, I'll do the pilgrimage.
Don't make me do it.
Undone pilgrimages.
You know what, I'm going to go with fantasies. Don't worry, you do the fantasy, I'll do the pilgrimage.
No, why do you think I said go to the food fantasy?
Well, food fantasies. Yes. Do I have to talk about them? They're deeply personal. I mean, it's just...
Remember, you asked for this on camera. You asked for this on camera.
I'm prepared.
No.
Go ahead.
I think every now and then in the country you get hit by a taste that's going to kill you. I mean, it's going to take your breath away. Punnu Swami in Chennai.
Dabeli.
Bojori Manna in Kolkata. Dabeli in Maharashtra.
Omiya Kathiawadi, Anand Gujarat.
Stop. Okay. Every now and then you're going to get hit by these flavors. And the tragedy is that you will never be able to replicate those in your immediate vicinity. Never. So I think if I would have a food fantasy, and I have several, which I care not to share with your viewers right now, it would be just access to all kinds of food. I mean, I go through great pains to get foods. He was in my house last week and we were eating kachoris from Jamnagar, which are incredible, with this little peanut chutney, which is fabulous. So yeah, I keep in touch with people, I write to them, I send them money and they send me food, and I pretty much play out all my fantasies. When you're as old as me, you know how to enjoy your fantasies.
Is there something that you've been looking for or that you haven't found or, you know, is not easy to come by?
No, but now that you ask, money will suffice. If you just give me money, I will be able to get access to those fantasies that have not yet been
fulfilled. Okay, like what?
But yeah,
if you had infinite money.
Seafood. The food of Kerala. Sadly, it is the furthest away. But the food of Kerala and the restaurants of Bangalore. If I had those around me, I would be a happy man. Because I already live in Delhi, so I already have Delhi around me. So I just need Kerala and Bangalore around.
Close by.
Before you move on to food pilgrimages, as a vegetarian, food fantasies. Don't you sometimes wish there are a lot more curries that are available to non-vegetarians? That, you know, like, for example, a Rogan Josh. You know, I mean, there are good paneer Rogan Joshes and stuff, but there are lots of curries that are exclusive to meats. And don't you wish that you had more vegetarian versions?
No, because a lot of those spices you can use, I don't know, I've never tried putting all of those in some kathal. But I would think that anything that you can put in chicken or mutton, you could cook with kathal and get exactly that gravy, exactly that flavor.
But people don't do that, at least in restaurants often.
No, in Kashmir they do a great kathal. You can't tell the difference between, you know, it's a Kashmiri Pandit dish made of kathal. It's like a spicy kathal and it tastes just like meat, like mutton.
Yeah.
And it has all the same flavors.
Kathal has always been the best meat substitute.
Yeah.
And that's one thing, since Rockies are all the senses, so that's taste. You can pretty much replicate it or get something not similar, because you're not comparing it with something, you're just enjoying it. I've always maintained that as a vegetarian, the visuals are much nicer in vegetarian food. Yeah. Just think of all the different colors of fruits and vegetables that you can cut up, whether it's in salads or whether it's in a sabzi. Meat, at least for me, for the most part, is just like a dark red color with like some stuff in it, or like slightly pink because of seafood.
Are you
so visually,
crazy?
I enjoy.
Are you crazy with meat?
Are you
queasy with me?
No, not at all. Not at all. I don't have a problem with it. I don't like the smell of seafood too much, but somebody's eating doesn't bother me. But so visually, I like it more. And I just think it works better for my system. Yeah. I tried a couple of pieces of meat here and there and didn't do anything for me. So I'm quite happy with the range of spices and tastes. And
it's interesting. I mean,
you can't ignore. If God didn't want you to eat meat, he wouldn't have made all the animals out of it. You know,
right.
So it is.
Refer to the 11th commandment that said you must eat.
We will immediately nip it in bud, the moral argument. Is it difficult for you to have a friend and colleague who is vegetarian and I mean, have you ever tried to convince him?
Are you kidding?
To?
We've been best friends for these years because we don't eat each other's food.
I mean, I've lived five houses away from Mayur or six, five houses away from him since 1976. So it worked really well for us. Here's the good thing. We both have very different tastes in girls, in movies, in music, in reading, and in food. So we've never really infringed on each other's territory. We have our own separate ways. And that really helps the friendship grow and develop. And, you know, we're men, after all. We don't have these emotional connects. We have this, don't step on my side of the line or I'll kick your butt. And don't step on my side or I'll kick your butt. And that works just fine for us here. So
okay.
We're good.
Target food pilgrimages.
Target food pilgrimage is something we haven't done yet. We've
I know exactly
which one.
Anywhere.
We've discussed those. No, I would say India. Why not there? We've done foods all over the country. We've traveled more than 65,000 kilometers in about 3.5 years. We've been able to sample some of the street food or what was Asian cuisine. But we also still firmly believe that a lot of that is still left alive in a lot of homes.
Mm.
So it would be awesome to now repeat this whole journey to go into like different homes of different communities. As Rocky said, every 100 miles, there's a new language, a new food. Yeah. To be actually able to go into the homes of people and get the grandmother's recipes there, and see how in some places they're still like grinding their spices right there, and you're eating it hot fresh, and you sit with the whole family and you eat it. I think that would be awesome, yeah, to be able to do that. NDTV Good Times, I hope you're listening. Please sponsor the next show where Rocky and Mayur get to go and eat at homes all over our amazing country and all the amazing food.
I'll answer you in a few short words. Amritsar, Madurai.
That's it? Amazing. They're both actually religious towns.
There you go. God is where the best food is, always. Have you got a few?
They weren't talking about the Golden Temple, right? The Meenakshi Temple.
Oh my God, it's not just the Golden Temple. It's Kesar Da Dhaba, it's Abuja Di Lassi.
All India famous.
It's
Kulcha.
Kanha Sweets, Amritsari Kulchas. Oh. I mean, you go mad.
Food porn.
That's food porn.
Where do we keep coming back?
I mean, Madurai has Brahmin cuisine. It has, traditional places that still do all their cooking on kernels of nuts. They don't use wood because the flavor changes. So we're talking about, frothy coffee made by hand for 3 rupees outside a little eatery on the street.
Mm.
It is spectacular. So if you're going to go to 2 places in life and you really want to find the meaning of God and existence and why you're here, go to Amritsar, go to Madurai, don't go to the temples, go and eat, and it is phenomenal. And if you're still wondering why God exists over there, then you can head on and go to the other places like the Golden Temple and the Meenakshi Temple. Is it the Meenakshi Temple or did I get it wrong?
Okay, this is the perfect point to end, and I think we'll end here.
I don't know, is it Meenakshi Temple?
Thank you, all of you. Get out there, get on the street, eat some street food, because that's what it's all about. Don't just sit around and waste your time eating packaged snacks and drinking alcohol.
Thank you to our generous host of Telga.
Oh, thank you. Nice. And it was a wonderful afternoon. It is perfect.
We can definitely cut now.
Really? No, don't stop now.